Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
U.S. to propose Israel settlement compromise. Al-Awlaki's father sues U.S. government over CIA hit list. And is the U.S. using the PKK to mount pressure on Turkey? Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu received a letter of guarantees from U.S. President Barack Obama in exchange for extending the settlement freeze for 2 months. The Israeli newspaper Maariv reported on the letter and described the guarantees as rare and unprecedented.
Following his meeting with U.S. Envoy George Mitchell, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu expressed hope for the negotiations with the Palestinian side to continue, despite what he called constraints that could derail the negotiations.
Ilyas Karam has the details.
يأتي المبعوث الأمريكي الخاص لعملية السلام جورج ميتشل إلى المنطقة للقاء المسؤولين الإسرائيليين.
U.S. Special Envoy for Middle East Peace George Mitchell came to the region to meet with Israeli and Palestinian officials. He is on a mission to prevent the collapse of the direct negotiations and overcome the settlement obstacle. Mitchell will meet with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu in an attempt to convince him to accept U.S. President Barack Obama's letter of guarantees. The letter calls on Israel to extend the settlement freeze for 2 additional months. In return, the American administration will pledge to provide Israel with advanced warfare weapons. In addition, it will pledge to defeat any Arab initiative in the UN Security Council that proposes a Palestinian state and will prevent the Palestinians from raising the settlement issue separately from final status issues.
The guarantees will allow Netanyahu to gain legitimacy and convince his coalition partners to continue the negotiations and freeze settlement construction. The second important issue is the existence of a movement, pressure, letters, and meetings and threats. This makes us hopeful.
The American administration wants to extend the settlement freeze in order to pave the way for the demarcation of the promised Palestinian state, in addition to sorting out the settlements that will remain under Israeli sovereignty and those that will be evacuated as part of the final solution.
This is an American issue. Our position is clear. The settlement freeze is the responsibility of Israel, and it has agreed to it in numerous signed agreements. We do not have to pay a price for Israel to stop these illegal acts that range from land theft to changing the reality on the ground. Our position on the settlement issue is clear. We will not resume the negotiations as settlement construction continues.
Netanyahu was embarrassed by and repudiated his foreign minister's statements, in which he talked about population exchange and peace, which he referred to as elusive and linked to Iran's nuclear file. Netanyahu's decision over whether or not to extend the settlement freeze will have a large impact on the Arab League's upcoming decision on threats endured by the Palestinian side over its withdrawal from the negotiations. Netanyahu seems to be stuck between the American administration and his extreme right-wing coalition. However, being a good manipulator, he is attempting to prevent a clash with the American president while preserving his coalition. He is often seen talking about peace, but frequently hides behind the wishes of his coalition partners.
Foreign Minister Avigdor Lieberman addressed the United Nations General Assembly a short time ago. Lieberman said that a Palestinian state is not a guarantee of peace and could take decades to be realized. He also blames the Palestinians for having wasted time by refusing direct peace talks for 9 months. Earlier, he met privately with UN Chief Ban Ki-moon, where the subject of Israel's renewal of construction in the West Bank settlements took center stage. Ban expressed his disappointment that Israel did not continue the moratorium. Lieberman said the blame lies with the Palestinians, who refused to talk to the Israelis.
You have already seen my statement, in which I have expressed my disappointment, despite the Quartet's call and whole international community's expectations. I conveyed the same message to Deputy Prime Minister and Foreign Minister Lieberman of Israel this afternoon, to whom I have asked to convey this message to leadership of Israel.
We decided about the moratorium 10 months ago as a unilateral gesture of goodwill to the Palestinians. During the 9 months, the Palestinians wasted time and completely refused to accept this gesture and accused Israel that it's a fraud, it's not serious. And today they're exerting a pressure to maintain the same moratorium that they previously rejected.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu personally repudiated the speech given by his foreign minister, Avigdor Lieberman, at the UN General Assembly, in which he proposed transferring the Palestinians of 1948 to the Palestinian state, if it is established, in exchange for transferring the settlements in the West Bank to Israel. The Israeli Prime Minister announced that Lieberman's address does not represent his government's official position. This comes as George Mitchell, the U.S. envoy to the Middle East, begins a new round in the region meant to support the negotiations process.
Amidst the boycott of the Iranian and Iraqi delegations at the UN General Assembly's ministerial meeting, the Israeli foreign minister cast more doubt on the prospect of the Israeli-Palestinian peace talks when he proposed transferring the Palestinians of 1948 to the state of Palestine if it is established. The minister said it would be possible to accomplish by only modifying the border and not displacing the residents.
Thus, the guiding principle for a final status agreement must not be land for peace, but rather exchange of populated territory. Let me be very clear, I'm not speaking about moving populations, but rather about moving borders to better reflect demographic realities. This is not an extraordinary insight, and it is far less controversial than some may seek to claim.
The Palestinian delegation considered Lieberman's address to be insulting, with the aim of getting rid of the Palestinians of 1948. In addition, the speech was immediately rejected by the Israeli Prime Minister. Benjamin Netanyahu's office indicated that Lieberman's speech was not coordinated with the Prime Minister. Also at the United Nations, Syrian Foreign Minister Walid Mualim talked about his country's readiness to resume indirect peace talks with Israel.
إن سوريا مستعدة لاستئناف مفاوضات السلام.
Syria is ready to resume peace negotiations from the point where they stopped through the Turkish mediator if it finds in Israel a partner committed to the terms of peacemaking.
However, the Syrian foreign minister also indicated that the Israeli-Palestinian negotiations might be derailed over settlement construction in the West Bank. This coincided with U.S. envoy George Mitchell's arrival in Israel to attempt to salvage the peace process, especially since the Palestinians do not see a reason to continue negotiations as Israel continues its settlement activities. Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas had granted the United States a deadline to convince Israel to renew the settlement freeze. The president said that he will decide whether or not to resume negotiations after the Arab League's foreign ministers meet on Monday. Ahmed Al-Sheikh, BBC.
أفادت وزارة الداخلية الألمانية بوجود معلومات عن هجمات لتنظيم القاعدة إلا أنها شددت على أنه
Germany's interior ministry said that it has no evidence that attacks by al-Qaeda on German soil are imminent. In what was attributed to intelligence sources, British media said Western intelligence agencies had foiled a plot in Pakistan to launch simultaneous terror attacks in Britain, France and Germany.
وفرنسا وألمانيا
إحباط المخطط الإرهابي الذي أعدته عناصر يعتقد أنها مرتبطة بالقاعدة.
The foiling of a terrorist plot allegedly hatched by members of Al-Qaeda in Pakistan was due to joint efforts by intelligence agencies in the US, Britain, France and Germany. Al-Qaeda was plotting to launch simultaneous terrorist attacks in major cities in Britain, France and Germany. Amidst growing fear, security agencies around Europe have heightened security measures in anticipation of terrorist attacks described as exceptional.
ونقل تقرير إعلامي بريطاني عن مصادر استخباراتية أن المخطط كان يتضمن
A British media report has quoted intelligence sources saying that the plot included the launch of terrorist attacks similar to the 2008 Mumbai bombings, which killed more than 160 people. However, the report said that there's evidence of imminent attacks. France has issued a warning to its citizens saying that a real attack is likely following the kidnapping of five French nationals in Niger.
مواطنيها من خطر حقيقي بعد خطف خمسة من رعاياها في النيجر.
The French police also evacuated the Eiffel Tower, the most notable tourist spot in the French capital, after receiving a false bomb threat. This was France's second bomb scare in 2 weeks and its fourth in a month.
لشهر فيما رفعت بريطانيا في يناير الماضي مستوى التهديد للإرهاب الدولي.
Last January, Britain raised its international terrorism threat level to severe, the second highest on its five-level terror alert system, confirming that deadly attacks are still likely. Nawal Ayad, Al Arabiya.
In another development, the Obama administration is seeking to persuade a U.S. federal judge to dismiss a lawsuit filed by the father of a Yemeni-American religious cleric, Anwar al-Awlaki. The case calls for halting the U.S. administration's plots to kill terrorist leaders on foreign soil without trials, even if they are U.S. citizens. Per Ghanim has the details.
This is an FBI wanted list. Nowhere on this list can you find a photo of Anwar al-Awlaki. However, the U.S. government wants him dead. Al-Awlaki is an American citizen of Yemeni descent.
The only legitimate response is through the transfer of individuals to U.S. federal courts.
Al-Awlaki attempted to blow up a civilian plane on Christmas Day in 2009. He made contact with Omar Farouk Abdul Muntalab and U.S. Army Major Nidal Hassan, who killed 13 soldiers last year at the U.S. Fort Hood military base. The U.S. government considers Al-Awlaki a very dangerous person.
This is a war just like any other war.
This is a war just like any other war. We want to kill them, and this man is a warrior who wants to kill U.S. citizens. This is a legitimate target, as if he's wearing military headgear and carrying a gun in the fort.
In a case filed by Nasser al-Awlaki, Anwar al-Awlaki's father, against President Obama, U.S. Secretary of Defense Minister Robert Gates, and CIA Director Leon Panetta, al-Awlaki asked a federal court to declare that targeted killing is unconstitutional. He also called for the halt of the U.S. government's plots to kill al-Awlaki and disclose the principles and guidelines used in the killing of a U.S. citizen.
There must be some type of due process that can be followed. They must listen to the testimonies and verify the evidence. None of this is happening now. They are making decisions behind closed doors. A group of irresponsible men is deciding to kill this man or another. With that, something must go wrong.
In response, the U.S. government said that it was not up to the court to decide how the president chooses to protect the nation from terrorist attacks. The U.S. Secretary of Defense said the trial would reveal military and intelligence secret privileges, which will help terrorists escape.
This is a strategy of essentially decapitating the head of terrorist networks. This means the killing of terrorist leaders and dismantling their networks, as well as preventing them from plotting and operating. This is a strategic tactic proven to be effective and successful in wars and against terrorism as well.
It's clear that U.S. President Barack Obama has doubled the number of targeted assassinations since his inauguration. He seems to prefer this method over the deployment of soldiers to a battlefield. It will be very difficult for him to change this policy. Pierre Ghanem, Al Arabiya, Washington.
Hi, I'm John Hamilton here with a question. Have you ever tried to discuss the Middle East with a neighbor or a friend and ended up feeling like you were hitting a brick wall? Well, maybe it's because they aren't armed with the same kind of knowledge that you receive every day through Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Where else on American television are you going to find reports from over 40 broadcasters from Pakistan to Morocco, Lebanon to Egypt? Where else can you find a very different perspective from what you'd see on Fox News or CNN? Well, these questions answer themselves. We know that Mosaic is an invaluable resource, but we need your help to keep this powerful program alive. One of the best ways to do that is to give a $100 donation today. With your contribution, you'll receive this great new Mosaic Intelligence Report t-shirt. It asks, do you have intelligence? Well, we know you do, and what better way to show the world your intelligence and your love for Mosaic than with this t-shirt? But if you'd really like to make a huge impact, consider donating $1,000 or more. As a token of our appreciation, you'll have lunch with the producer of Mosaic, Jamal Dejani, and the entire crew that makes Mosaic possible. Ever wonder what it takes to make Mosaic? Well, you can find out. You'll also tour the Mosaic newsroom to see what it takes to create a new episode every day. I'm confident we can make our $100,000 goal this month, but we need your support. So please give us a call at 866-485-8848 or go online to linktv.org/contribute. And from everyone here at Link TV, thank you.
Did you know that a simple text message could help Mosaic in a big way? When you text Link TV to 85944, you'll instantly make a $10 donation to Mosaic and Link TV. So pick up your cell phone and send us a text. Support Mosaic today.
In response to a call by the European Trade Union Confederation, massive protests were held today across several European countries against government austerity measures. Demonstrations over austerity measures were held in Spain, Greece, Portugal, and Ireland. Nearly 100,000 are expected to take part in a demonstration in Brussels, where the EU has its headquarters. Sagar Salam reports.
The austerity measures taken, or soon to be taken, by European governments have agitated the European public and sparked wide labor protests. The austerity measures, which aim to combat the international financial crisis, have angered European workers and labor unions.
In a case like this, we have no choice but to do something often seen in sports, which is to raise the red card in the face of governments and tell them to go home.
The European Trade Confederation has called for a massive demonstration in Brussels to coincide with an official meeting for EU ministers of finance. Nearly 100,000 protesters are expected to take part in the Brussels demonstration, the largest anti-austerity protest in Europe. In addition, dozens of protests and strikes were staged across various European capitals, paralyzing traffic, including Madrid, the Spanish capital.
We don't have money to pay our bills. Soon we will lose our jobs. Once this happens, we will be forced to leave the country.
The only thing the government is good at is how to test our nerves.
European nerves are being tested today amidst plans to impose austerity measures. The European continent is ailing, according to the people here, due to its deteriorating economy and incompetent governments, which so far have not been able to counter the international financial crisis.
France is in the midst of political controversy. The French government is considering a new law that would strip naturalized French citizens of nationality. The new law, set to undergo debate until November 12th, is part of a proposal drafted by French President Nicolas Sarkozy after French police came under fire by immigrant youth in Paris suburbs. The French opposition believes the law is politically and electorally motivated and aims to distract the nation from its economic problems. The law is also facing strong opposition from French legal and human rights groups.
The Sarai building in Diyala province is considered one of the historic landmarks of the city. Built a long time ago, this building has today become a cultural center for the local people. Fadl Zaidi has the report.
للأبنية التراثية في حياة الشعوب دلالات وأهمية.
Some historic buildings have significant meaning in people's lives because they play a role as a communication center for people of different generations. The Sarai building in Diyala province is one of them. Sarai witnessed an important era in Iraq's history, the establishment of the modern Iraqi state.
هذه البناية اتخذت مقرا للحكومة العراقية منذ عام 1920 حتى.
This building was used as the Iraqi government's headquarters from the 1920s to the mid-1960s. Then another building was built for the government, and Sarai became a training center for female teachers. Later, it was turned into a lecture hall for students from different departments.
مقرًا للأقسام الداخلية للطلبة فيما بعد. في منتصف الثمانينات.
In the mid-80s, it was used as the headquarters for cultural organizations, including the Writers Association of Diyala Province, People's Poets Association, the Iraqi Photography Association, and the Iraqi Maqam Music Association. All these organizations used to have their events here in this building.
This historic building was constructed when the Ottomans ruled Iraq. It witnessed the British Army's occupation of Iraq, as well as the expulsion of the British governor from Iraq after the 1920 revolution. It celebrated the establishment of Diyala province during the monarchy era. Today, it is still a historic gift to the local people and has become a symbol of culture in the province.
This ancient building, Sarai, in the city of Bakuwa, is considered one of the few historic buildings in Diyala province that is still solid. Or we can say that it is the only one in Bakuwa city that represents the conflicted Islamic Ottoman era of Iraq. This era, which lasted more than seven centuries, was an important time in the history of the Islamic countries in general and in the history of Iraq specifically. This building's name is derived from the Ottoman word for palace or sarai, which was what they called government buildings and the residential houses attached to them. This isn't just the case in Iraq, but also in Egypt, Lebanon, Syria, and other Islamic countries that were ruled by the Ottoman Turks in the medieval centuries. After the British occupation and the establishment of the Iraqi government in the 1920s, this building was used as the headquarters for the Iraqi government acting on behalf of the Diyala province.
ناقشنا في الحلقة الماضية ما يشوب العلاقات الأمريكية.
The warnings issued by U.S. President Barack Obama to Turkish Prime Minister Recep Tayyip Erdogan over his country's efforts to seek rapprochement with Iran at the expense of the Zionist entity is further straining U.S.-Turkish relations. In this episode of America and the World, we will assess the pressure mounted by Washington on Ankara, both at the national and regional levels, and the ramifications they may trigger.
على المستوى الداخلي والإقليمي وما يمكن أن ينتج.
I would like to welcome in our studio Dr. Mohammad Nuruddin, an expert on Turkish affairs. But first, let's watch the following report on the various stages of U.S.-Turkish relations.
شهدت علاقة واشنطن مع أنقرة نوعا من الفتور.
The first sign of the strain in the relations between Ankara and Washington started to appear on the horizon after the Erdogan government accepted the role of mediator in the Iranian nuclear showdown. Turkey, along with Brazil, helped broker the Tehran declaration for a possible nuclear swap deal between Iran and Western powers. In addition, Turkey voted against the UN Security Council resolution calling for additional sanctions on Tehran. Turkey also adopted a hostile position toward Israel in the aftermath of the Israeli massacre on board the Freedom Flotilla. This prompted the U.S. administration to warn Turkey over its growing animosity for the Israeli entity after successfully blocking Ankara from condemning Israel at the UN Security Council. Turkish Prime Minister Recep Tayyip Erdogan has constantly demanded that Israel lift its blockade on the Gaza Strip. Erdogan also called for the formation of an international inquiry panel, a formal apology by Israel, and retribution for the crime committed by Israel on board the Freedom Flotilla. The Obama administration has expressed concern over Turkish rapprochement efforts with Iran and Syria at the expense of its relations with the Israeli entity. Washington believes that such a shift in the Turkish position poses a threat to the U.S. strategy in the region, especially in its absolute commitment for Israel's security and military superiority. Also, the Syrian-Iranian-Turkish axis will help weaken the U.S.'s Arab allies in the region, known as the Moderate Arab Forces.
Dr. Muhammad Nur al-Din, are we seeing more pressure mounted on Ankara by the U.S., especially by its military institution?
Through various fronts, the U.S. is seeking to change the status quo in Turkey. This has become more obvious, especially in the aftermath of the U.S.-led occupation of Iraq. More than 5,000 members of the Kurdistan Workers' Party, the PKK, are currently present in Kurdish areas under U.S. auspices. I'm not saying that the PKK is operating under the U.S. umbrella. Historically, the PKK has adopted a political position that is quite the opposite of that adopted by the U.S. Having said that, the mere fact that the PKK is present in northern Iraq puts it at the U.S.'s disposal. The U.S. is seeking to use the PKK as a tool to mount pressure on the Turkish government. It was not a coincidence that some of the large Kurdish military operations, including the launch of missiles on the Iskenderun base, came only a few hours before the Israeli attack on the Freedom Flotilla. There appears to be a number of political fragmentations inside and outside Turkey, which the U.S. is trying to use in order to change the status quo in the country. The popularity of the Justice and Development Party is the only shield that is helping protect Turkey from any possible hostile change of the ruling regime by the U.S.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible from support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online, stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.